This energy storage system is not like others. It's made up of repurposed batteries from electric cars.
This is the world's largest deployment of reused second life transportation batteries. And we believe it's also the largest microgrid operating in North America today.
This is an incredibly low cost and simple way to deploy a huge amount of energy onto the grid.
The 63 megawatt hour microgrid is powering two modular data centers for AI infrastructure company Crusoe at Redwood Materials' new battery recycling facility in Nevada.
The key constraint for AI computing has really become energy and access to electrical power. What you see here is a completely new vision for how this can be done.
J.B. Straubel is one of the co-founders of Tesla and served as its chief technology officer until 2019. He founded Redwood Materials in 2017 to recycle batteries and create a sustainable closed-loop supply chain for EVs and other clean energy products.
We have about 70% of the total aggregation collection of material in North America. That really means that those batteries are not getting sent to landfills. Those aren't getting wasted.
But as Redwood started receiving more EV batteries, it noticed most still have usable capacity. Rather than recycle those, it's now repurposing them for microgrid projects that could provide cheap energy storage for new and existing data centers.
We're just finding a way to bring a little bit more value out of those batteries and reuse them before we recycle them.
In the energy industry, the holy grail has been 24/7 renewable power, but the cost of batteries was too high until today. This changes that.
When CNBC first visited Straubel's battery recycling startup in 2021, it was just getting its operations off the ground. 4 years later, it has grown exponentially.
We have substantially increased the amount of material that we are processing, maybe by a factor of, you know, almost 20. We have commissioned multiple lines, multiple factories to handle that material.
The company previously recycled out of Carson City, Nevada, but has since expanded its operations to a new campus just down the street from Tesla's Gigafactory.
This facility here in Sparks, we're vertically integrated all the way through incoming batteries and materials, storage, sorting, then initial processing and refining, and as well into material manufacturing. So this is also the site of our first cathode manufacturing factory behind us here.
Redwood is also building an even larger battery recycling plant in South Carolina.
It's 600 acres. The one we're at here is 300 acres. And we intend to do more or less the same thing, but bigger there. Many of America's battery plants are on the East Coast, so it makes logistical sense to set up a hub near the port of Charleston there and close to the battery plants that are on the eastern side of the U.S.
The company takes in and recycles everything from batteries and consumer devices such as cell phones, laptops, and power tools, all the way to the massive batteries used in EVs from the likes of Tesla, Ford, BMW, and others.
We today get material from well over 100 different companies and partners. Generally, I'd say today, you know, often the problem is almost feeling like too many batteries. It's a constant, you know, tug of war between the parts of the company that are out there, you know, finding all the batteries and the other parts that are processing and scaling up our operations.
And as EV adoption has grown, so has the number of car batteries reaching end of life.
Today, EV batteries and those type of materials are the fastest growing part of our feedstock. That's growing, you know, almost 100% per year, doubling every single year right now.
As Redwood scaled up its recycling operations, an opportunity presented itself.
The electric vehicle batteries, many of them had most of their useful life remaining. And so we thought, really, wouldn't it make more sense to take advantage of the utility they still had rather than feeding them directly back into recycling?
In many cases, it may still have 50 to 80% of its capacity remaining. And it's a shockingly high number we're already seeing can be repurposed.
Energy storage is still the fastest growing battery demand market. It does make sense to access that demand. Where Redwood can really set itself apart is in that circularity piece, obviously coming from a battery recycling background. There's a really big appeal to using batteries that otherwise would have been scrapped or recycled.
Redwood begins the process by evaluating the battery's health and capacity.
When we receive a battery, the first thing we do is we just look at it physically. Is it in good shape? Mechanically, is there obvious damage? We do a very brief electrical check just to see that their cells are healthy enough to be put into energy storage use.
Once the batteries have been validated, they can then be deployed into its energy storage array.
We integrate those into this technology platform we have that can basically plug an EV battery pack into an array and allow it to function as a as a greater whole in a large energy storage project. And we're deploying these projects into large, you know, assemblies of batteries, hundreds to even tens of thousands of batteries, to serve a common goal of supporting a manufacturing center or perhaps a data center to firm up renewable energy.
Redwood designed the system to accept batteries from a variety of sources. GM recently announced it will collaborate with Redwood to provide both new U.S. manufactured batteries and second life battery packs from EVs. But the company is primarily using the packs it receives through its existing recycling operations.
This little gray box here, we call that our universal translator. It's a sophisticated piece of power electronics engineered by Redwood that really allows us to plug in any battery pack from any manufacturer.
The hardest part about this was really the power electronics and the software controls, so that we can deploy, you know, a battery that might only have 10 or 20% capacity remaining right next to one that might have 80 or 90%.
The microgrid is actively monitored and batteries are replaced as they wear out.
You unplug the pack, you bring a forklift over, you move it aside, you bring a new one in and you plug it in again. So it's a very quick operation, maybe 30 seconds, hot swap, and then you're off and running again. The energy and the power contained in each pack is monitored second by second.
And these repurposed batteries are expected to be useful for several years to come.
We're seeing and expecting somewhere in the ballpark of 3 to 5 years of additional lifetime beyond the automotive application. And that's enough time to make it well worth the cost to deploy it.
But being a second life system, it does come with a few trade-offs.
We're more active on these projects, you know, day to day, month to month, sometimes replacing batteries, you know, swapping them, actively managing the project to maintain its capacity. We also take a little bit more land area. And you know, that's something that we did intentionally to make the management and swapping easy, and also to manage safety in a very passive way.
Your battery management system and your battery health management needs to be excellent. The potential for thermal runaway does complicate things. Safety is, you know, of the highest priority, not only from the fact that it's dangerous, but it's a huge financial cost if you're front-ending all of this CapEx to build these systems and then it goes down because of a thermal runaway event.
Redwood will now be competing in a growing energy storage market with established leaders like Tesla, which has built a successful energy business with its megapack grid-scale storage. But experts see plenty of room for new entrants to meet demand.
Tesla's been doing this for a long time now. Their systems are very advanced. They are on the premium end of the scale as well in terms of pricing. I wouldn't say they're a direct competitor, no. I would imagine this second life is going to be used for slightly smaller projects, potentially with clients where cost is a little bit more of a limiter.
Electricity demand is accelerating at an unprecedented pace, with AI and data centers needed to power it being a big driver. By 2028, it's estimated data centers alone could consume 12% of US energy.
It certainly is the buzz topic at the moment, data center demand and AI boosting that energy demand. It's generally a case of needing everything everywhere all at once.
Sourcing power and working with utilities is a major hurdle for hyperscalers building data centers. Redwood saw an opportunity to pilot its microgrid technology to help solve this problem.
There is just no way to connect them to the grid fast enough. So what we did here in less than 5 months was bring up a new data center without a connection to the grid. I think there's tremendous opportunity to scale this up into the hundreds of megawatts or gigawatts.
For its first microgrid, it partnered with Crusoe, best known for the massive AI data center it's building in Abilene, Texas, as a part of the Stargate project, a $500 billion initiative to build AI data center infrastructure backed by OpenAI, Oracle, SoftBank, and others.
We build the world's largest AI data centers, and we operate large clusters of GPU compute for AI workloads.
The global data center market is experiencing a surge in growth due to the AI boom. AI is estimated to drive a 165% increase in data center power demand by 2030.
Data centers have been really, I'd say, the largest driver of electricity growth, and energy storage, the type that we're deploying here, solves a number of really key and fascinating problems for those data center customers.
Usually batteries were either too expensive or subscale. And so what this is showing is a new model that solves that problem. This is cost-effective, rapidly deployable, scalable, 24/7 renewable power, and AI data center computing as one integrated package.
The microgrid, which generates 12 megawatts of power and has 63 megawatt hours of capacity, powers two modular data centers built by Crusoe.
Inside those are NVIDIA GPU hardware that are operating AI workloads, which are being powered by 100% solar power through these Second Life EV batteries. So this is the lowest cost form of power storage that really exists in the market today.
We have a potential, I think, to be, you know, maybe half the cost of new lithium-ion batteries for larger installations. And that, again, comes with a little higher management cost and an ongoing, you know, maintenance cost of the project. But in the analysis we see, this more than makes up for the initial cost reduction.
If you were to build a traditional data center, often you're going to be quoted timelines that are 2 years to 4 years or more, depending on the scale and the nature of the data center. Here we deployed all this infrastructure, including all the electrical and power generation infrastructure, in about 5 months. This is a perfect way to scale up on the edge, meaning small data centers located near population centers, where the speed between the user and the data center matters a lot. Or this can also be used to scale up existing data centers, or if somebody wants on-site computing at their facility.
And the deployment of the battery packs themselves, that took less than 1 month. So it was incredibly fast and incredibly low labor to deploy this.
Redwood says it has over a gigawatt hour of reusable batteries in its inventory, the equivalent of 12,500 EVs, and is designing 100 plus megawatt projects, up to 10 times the size of the pilot microgrid with Crusoe.
The scalability of this really doesn't have a limit. You know, we can use the same type of architecture behind me here and scale this up by a factor of 100 or more.
We're already working on some of those scaled developments together.
And with several million EVs on U.S. roads today, the company says there will be plenty of batteries available for such projects in the years to come.
The batteries coming back into possible reuse is going to keep growing every single year. And per our estimations, you know, this can be a very significant part of the overall energy storage mix going onto the U.S. grid. Maybe upwards of 50%, even for decades to come.
There's going to be a tremendous amount of energy storage like this coming to us. And now that we've proven the cost model, the basic technology works well, we're really in a phase where we're excited to scale it to much bigger projects.
The scale of Second Life build-out thus far has been negligible, but that's not to say that it doesn't have a role to play. Battery demand across all segments reached a terawatt hour last year, and we're still right at the bottom of where our forecast goes towards, you know, 2040. The future demand for energy storage specifically is massive, so it's not surprising that players who traditionally haven't been in this space are looking to enter this space because the business case is so clear.
This is really a new vision for how the AI infrastructure of the future can be powered in a sustainable, cost-competitive, and rapidly scalable way. It's really modular, so it can really Lego block together from any small scale all the way up to very large scale.
For us, this has been a phenomenal chance to integrate a new business unit into our existing mix profitably while still building upon our sustainability mission.